With the same spirit, the number is 202. Jesus says, "Your pilot." Don't worry about time. We are in church. We have borrowed the 30 minutes from the first service to bring it to the second service. Thank you. you praise Him. We are singing it because He has delivered us. This week we are here. If you don't believe that it's God, I don't know. All has been said, and let us go to the wedding. Now that everybody has relaxed to taking this time doing other things, can I take my time off? We go into the book of John, chapter 1, the verses 43 to 50. In the same note, I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, amen. You have found it, you shall say amen. The book of John, chapter 1, the verses 43 to 51. I'm reading it in your hearing. The following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him, of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see him." Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him and said to him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." And Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you hereafter, you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." May God bless the reading of His word. Amen. In recent times, what I've been doing, I have not been praying or reading the Word of God using hermeneutics, if I'm pronouncing that word right. Looking for hidden meanings, looking for ways that are profound. That's not what I've been interested in. What I've been interested in is to look at the trends and look at the behavior of characters in the Bible. And one of those that got to me in the last 3-4 years was to study human beings, just the behavior, in relationship to me. To say, why is it when good things happen, we take the glory to God? It is because God is a God of glory, is a God of good things. But at the same time, when bad things happen, we attribute bad things to the devil. And then I ask myself, what is my role in this person? Because there's three parties. There is God the side, there's the devil the side, I'm here. You see, the reason I'm saying that is because there's a whole lot of bad things or bad decisions that we take, and we always blame the devil. And because we are always blaming someone, we will never get to a point of being corrected. And as I listen or as I read and ask myself this question, I get to study the characters and the patterns. You know? And when I was preaching the week of prayer, I preached about the mind of a man. It's so amazing that God does wonderful things for human beings. The next moment, they forgot. That's so amazing. And I'm going to be referring to those here and there. Take it from a married man like me to say, it is very frustrating to be in a relationship where you always have to put yourself busy. It is very frustrating to be in a relationship where you always have to prove your allegiance, where you always have to prove your commitment, where you always have to prove your worth, where you always have to prove your love that you are here. You do it daily, you get to a point of getting tired. You get to a point of saying, but I'm not going anywhere, I'm here and I'm doing these things on a daily basis. And the reason I'm saying that is because when I take this example that I just offered now, or I just said, God is in a relationship with his children. There's a relationship here. And that was born so many years ago during creation. But in this relationship, human beings are the ones who are making mistakes. Human beings are the ones who are ill. But God is the one who always has to prove himself to us. And the question is why? Because God is not the one who's sinning. Human beings are the ones who are sinning. But it's the same God, day in, day out, who's blessing us with miracles and blessings and so many things, but we expect him to prove. He proved himself today. We are here, we are here, sitting here. But there's someone here doubting that I'm not going to get his life. And these are the kind of questions that I come across and say, human beings want God to prove his power daily, God to prove his goodness daily, God to prove his loyalty to us daily, God to prove his commitment to us daily, and God to be with us on a daily basis. Even though he said, how many of us came in the morning, God be with us today, but as soon as you leave the house, you forgot that you invited him. And you conduct yourself throughout the day, forgetting that you invited the Messiah himself to be with you throughout the day. And then later on, you pray a prayer as if he was not there, but you ask him in the morning to be with you. For those who are planning to sleep, if you are planning to sleep, then the title of the sermon is, what would it take? What would it take? Then you can sleep. Now, allow me to categorize the generations in these three categories. We have the Old Testament generation, and we have the New Testament generation in the Bible. And then we have the present generation, which is me and you. Let us study some of the examples. The reason we read John 1, verse 33, I am not interested currently in to say that John and Nathaniel said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? We all know that people have a tendency of judging you based on where you come from. In case you didn't know, at home, I grew up. Making traditional beer. You give me the ingredients right now, I can make unkombo, traditional beer, good yeast and everything. You're all gonna get drunk. I grew up in that house, in a two-room shack, where I'll get King Kong Combomel, I'll get maize meal, I'll get yeast, I'll get sugar. And guess what? The people who drink that, after you make it today, they don't want it tomorrow. But when it's last, I don't know what you call it in English. They want it after 2 days because it's strong enough. When you open that bin, the smell in there, you're all drunk. And based on your background, people will look at that, no, there's no doctor that can come out of here. So, you see, here Nathaniel was not questioning whether Jesus Christ was going to come because he knew Jesus Christ was going to come. It is, where is he going to come from? Can anything good come out of his family? You know, there are generational curses whereby the father is a drunkard, the mother is a drunkard, and so many bad things are happening, and they go like, you will never get married. I am not interested in that. That's a sermon for the other day. What I'm interested here is that they tell Nathaniel and say, we have found him. He's hearing, but he does not believe it. He says, come, let us go and show it. Christians believe in hearing, but it's not enough. They believe in seeing, but it's not enough. The question is, what would it take for you to have faith? I am interested in those two things. We have found the Messiah. You know that he's coming. You don't believe. Let us go, because you don't believe. You want to see him? Yes. Now let us go to the Old Testament. There's a tree burning. Who has ever seen a tree on fire but it's not burning? Anyone? A miracle is happening, and God is saying to Moses, I want you to go to Egypt because I want you to deliver the children of Israel. Moses is hearing the message, but he does not believe, because he wants God to prove himself day in and day out. How many times did God try to prove to Moses that, hey, I am God, and go there and do this thing? And not only that, how many miracles did Moses perform? The throwing of the rod down there, the snakes, and there's so many things that God had to do on a daily basis. The question is, how many miracles do you have to see for you to believe in God? What will it take? What will it take for me to really, really believe in God? You pray today, I need food. You get food. Tomorrow you are sick. God, what am I going to do? As if God was never there. Is this pharma stuff? Faith? that you pump tomorrow and finish. And I think it is enough. I like referring to this one because I had the privilege of going to the sea. And I go there, and then I look at the sea. You know, every time I go to nature, that's why the Bible says, leave the cities and go to nature, because nature will remind you who God is. I stand there in the sea and go like, this thing is big. The way it's so big, you just see creation, you just see God. God has parted the sea. Has parted the sea. And the children of Israel, they pass there. And then after passing, they forget. How do you forget that? Please help me. Am I the only person here who's going? How do you forget a God who has parted the sea? And then you pass in thousands and thousands. And after that, the moment you get this side, you start worshiping other gods. God has provided manna for them as they were walking. They didn't have food. He gave them food. But the following day, they said, what is this God still here? What's happening? Because human beings have a tendency of forgetting quickly. Quickly. And I don't know why. That is in the Old Testament when we take some of the examples. Abraham and Sarah. God comes to them and says, I'm going to give you a child. Sarah does not believe. God had to prove, because Sarah had to not believe. God proved it. So there's a couple of examples that we can use. Moses never reached the promised land. God, in Joshua 1, verse 5, he said, Joshua, I will be with you the same way I was with Moses. Mind you that God never said, Joshua, you must become Moses. Because it's not about Moses, it's about God who was with Moses. Now that God is with Joshua. And based on that verse, ever since I read it, I don't believe in the role models. The role model does not exist because if God was not with Moses, Moses would not be a hero that he is today. It is about the God. I want God to be with me in the same way as he is with Pastor Hall. That is what I'm supposed to say. I want God to be with him, me, the same way as he is with my parents. I don't want to be like my parents. I want to be like my God who is in my parents. But the question is, what God is in you? So there's so many examples in the Bible, in the Old Testament, whereby God says this, he proved himself, people don't believe. God says this, he proved himself, people don't believe. God says this. Now let's move to the New Testament. When you go to the New Testament, we found Jesus Christ is born in the book of Matthew, chapter 1. There's 14 generations, as you read it there, from Abraham to Jesus Christ, to the birth of Jesus Christ. You can hum a song in the meantime. Now, we are in the New Testament, and in the New Testament, I'm going to take a few examples. And these examples, I'm not going to take far, I'm going to look at the disciples themselves, the people who are with Jesus Christ on a daily basis. The people who were, Jesus Christ fed 5,000 people. And who was there amongst them? The disciples. The same disciples, the following day, Jesus Christ had to perform another miracle for them to believe that this is the Messiah. The question is, what kind of a miracle did Jesus Christ perform for you to believe? And they were walking with Jesus Christ on a daily basis. When you look at chapter 7 of Luke, that's my favorite book right there. Dr. Luke is something else, he's special. Dr. Luke, he says in Luke chapter 7, the book of John, John the Baptist. John the Baptist was a cousin to Jesus Christ. The age gap, when you read the Bible, the age gap between John the Baptist and Jesus Christ is 6 months. Because Mary, the mother of Jesus Christ, when he visited Elizabeth, who is the cousin to Mary, she was 6 months pregnant. And John was in the mother's womb at that time. When Mary entered the house, John tumbled and he did some spinning tricks or whatever in the mother's womb. He knew Jesus Christ when he was still in his mother's womb. And as if it is enough, you look in Matthew where now Jesus Christ is grown and then he needs to be baptized. He stands over there and then the word of the Lord saying, this is my child, you will be our Lord. Referring to Jesus Christ. Who baptized Jesus Christ? John the Baptist. Later on, John the Baptist is in prison. When he gets in prison, he sends two people who say, go and ask this man if he is the Messiah or should we wait for another one. He knew him when he was in his mother's womb. Because of the situation, now he says, you must prove yourself. Is it only me? He knew before he was born, he knew the Messiah. That is why he was talking in the widow's womb. As if that is enough, the disciples were empowered in the book of Luke chapter 9. He said, go into the city. And as you go into the city, I'm giving you power over the demons to heal the sick and so many things. This was the Messiah who walked with them. On a daily basis, he's saying, go into the city. I've given you power to do the healing. The demons, you are above them. You can cast them out. Jesus Christ died. And then he resurrected. But now they need proof that I do the Messiah. How many people did Jesus Christ have? Well, what's the word? Raised from the dead. When the disciples walked with him on a daily basis, how many people did you say, right? The same people, they think that the Messiah cannot die and get up. Really? You see, there was a battle in heaven. And the battle is between Jesus Christ and the devil. And the price was new. And the auction was saying 1,000 rands for me, and the other one was saying 1 million, the other one was saying 5 million, the other was saying 10 million, the other was saying, and Jesus Christ said, right. I'm giving my life for this person. You know why the devil never encountered the life one? He's going to raise it. After he says, okay, I'm going to die for these people that you love the most. If the devil dies, who's going to wake him up from death? And that is why Jesus Christ, because I am the breath of life. I'm the one who gives life, and I'm the one who does everything. He says, I'm willing to die for them because I know I can rise again for them. But the devil could not do that. Hey, it is finished. But what surprises me is that Jesus Christ also walked on water. Who has ever walked on water? There was someone last week where apparently you science people, they say you have to travel at the speed of 110, 120 kilometers per hour to be able to walk on water. That's the speed that you need. But the preacher said, Jesus, you are just on water. And these are the same people who are doubting Jesus Christ. And that was the New Testament generation. Now let us come to us. People pray for so many things to get delivered. When they get delivered, they still complain. Denzel Washington says, if you pray for the rain, be prepared to deal with the mouth. You can't be praying for marriage and you don't want to deal with marriage issues. You can't be praying for children and you don't want to deal with children issues. You can't be praying for spiritual life, but you don't want to deal with spiritual issues. Because you're going to deal with the spiritual issues because you pray for the spiritual life. A lot of us are. God, you have a family. What more do you want? God has blessed you. What more? What kind of complaints? What must happen for us? It's because I'm just proving from the Old Testament to the current generation, to the New Testament, to the current generation that, you know, family, what is the word? We are not content and we'll never be content because why? This God of ours. Over and over. The question is, until when? Until when are you going to complain? Until when are you going to have doubt? I have seen people going for prayer when somebody is sick. They pray, and then as soon as they come out, and then you ask, oh, you want to see somebody, and say, how is that person doing? And they go like, oh, it's not nice. It's not promising. But you just prayed. What kind of a faith did you pray there? What kind of a faith did you pray there? Or it was just an exercise. You prayed, but hey, no, this one is going. Then don't come and pray for me. Because we need to work on our faith. We need to work on our spirituality. I think that is enough. We believe in the God. We need to for God to hear. But the Father. Of the Torah's blessings, let them build me a tabernacle so that I can dwell amongst them. And God came down and he tabernacled with the children of Israel, but still they continued to sin. That's one part of. Hello, somebody talk to me? One part of of what he had. And now, in the book of Matthew, Jesus Christ is born. He came down to earth to humanity because God loves us so much because he's a God who is continually going to be proven to us that I'm God, I'm consistent. You are the one who is inconsistent. Jesus Christ comes down, and then he lives with us, he sets examples, and in the same process, what we do, we continue sinning, we continue not believing in him. That is true of. And in Matthew 28, he says, I am living, but I'm not leaving you alone. I'm leaving you with one, the Comforter. The Comforter is the only one that we have right now. If you count, God the Father was there, God the Son was there, God the Holy Spirit is here, there is no one there to comfort. The one who's going to come is Jesus Christ. And the prophet says, if there's a time where we need the Lord, it's now. Because the Comforter is here. The question is, what kind of a miracle, what kind of knowledge, what kind of a Bible study do you have to go through for you to have faith? Because Jesus Christ has performed the law. The fact that I'm talking to you right now is a miracle. Because I am a sinner myself. If Jesus Christ is to come here and count my sins, I'm going to drop the mic. I'm not worthy of preaching. The whole Trinity of God the Head has come down for humanity. And he has promised he will never leave us. The next time you complain, ask yourself this. Which God are you complaining to? Because the God that we complain to is the God who hears our prayers every time. An example is in Isaiah. Hezekiah was sick unto death. And then he cried unto the Lord and said, Lord, I've been a good servant to you. But what I like about that is that the response that God gave him, and I'm paraphrasing it, is turn around and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, I have heard his prayer. God who hears prayer. For a moment, let us stop complaining to God. Let us praise and worship God because he's forever present. May God bless the name of his Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, only